If you have your Bibles, I'd ask you to turn to the book of 1 Chronicles, chapter 29. 1 Chronicles, chapter 29. Trust you've been praying for our services this morning. 1 Chronicles chapter 29, we're going to begin reading in verse 11. 1 Chronicles chapter 29, beginning in verse 11, the Bible says, "Thine, O Lord, is the greatness, and the power, and the glory, and the victory, and the majesty. All that is in the heaven and in the earth is thine. Thine is the kingdom, O Lord, thou art exalted as the head above all. Both riches and honor come of thee, and thou reignest over all, and in thy hand is power and might, and in thy hand is to make great and to give strength unto all. Now therefore, O God, we thank thee and praise thy glorious name." Excuse me. "But who am I, and what is my people, that we should be able to offer so willingly after that sort? For all things come of thee, and of thine own have we given thee. For we are strangers before thee, and sojourners as were our fathers. Our days on the earth are as a shadow, and there is none abiding. O Lord our God, all this store that we have prepared to build thee for in a house, for thy holy name cometh of thy hand, and is all thine own. I know also, my God, that thou triest the heart, thou hast pleasure in uprightness. As for me, in the uprightness of my heart, I have willingly offered all these things. And now I have seen with joy the people who are present here to offer willingly with thee." Dear Lord, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for your goodness. Lord, we praise you for all that you do. We praise you this morning for just simply being seated on the throne. We give you great glory and honor for that. Lord, we praise you of the intercessor, Lord, the person of Christ. Lord, we have no approach without him. Lord God, we pray that you would help us as a people this morning. We stand needy. We'd love to hear from you this morning. We'd love that you would meet with us. Lord God, we pray for the lost this morning, that this might be the day of redemption for them. If they don't know you, Lord, that you might manifest yourself to them, that you might save their unworthy souls because of your own glory, we pray it. Amen. Now, we'll be preaching this morning on trying your heart, of knowing what's within there, knowing what is in your inner man, knowing what really makes you tick and what you're about. Where we live and in the atmosphere all of you were raised up in, pretty much we know what to say. We know how to say it. We can be pretty convincing. But have you ever tried your own heart? Yeah. You know, when I was a young man and doing some things maybe wasn't very becoming of a Christian, I had a lot of young friends, if I could call them friends, that says, "Come on, try this. You'll like it." Now, the sad truth is many times they were right, because this flesh is filthy. Mm-hmm. But try. Now, what you need to know is to try yourself. Compare it to the real, compare it to the fake, and see what you got. Because I'm fearful today that what a lot of people have is something fake. Something not real. You know, the Bible says that he will give us an enduring love. That's a love that will last throughout all eternity. And people that are here today and gone tomorrow, I don't have much faith in them. And I'll even go a step further. People that can't be engaged in church, there's a problem there. You know, just because you attend doesn't mean you're at church. You could be on the back 40 thinking about something that has nothing to do whatever concerning the kingdom of God. And so we need to try ourselves very, very frequently to be sure that we're exactly where we need to be. This is a very familiar verse of Scripture. It's David's final address to his people. He is just before dying, just before that time where he, as the Bible says, got no heat. And he was in an active dying state, and this is how he wanted to be remembered. Now, I'd also ask you this, how do you want to be remembered? Do you want to be remembered just being nice? You know, nothing wrong about being kind, but you know, I would to God this morning that there'd be something a little bit more significant to say about me than that I was a nice man. I want to be someone that would be remembered for defending the truth. And not only just defending the truth with the Bible. You know, I've seen a lot of people defend lies just by screaming. And it didn't mean a whole lot to me because they didn't have any Bible to back it up with. And so we see as David is fixing to die, and things are kind of, at the very end, he sees things in a brand new way. And so he begins off and says, "Thine, O Lord, is the greatness." We need to consider how great God is, and how insignificant we are, and that he would seem fit to use us and do things through us in order to thrill our heart. No, it ought to be that we feel burdened to come to the house of God, and that when we get here, we've done God some kind of service.
Yeah.
But rather, we ought to be able to give him great glory and power. Listen, he's sovereign. He's on the throne this morning, and the only reason you have breath of life even today is because of God's goodness. And you know what? On the flip side of that, he could snuff it out in a moment's notice. We're not guaranteed of any kind of tomorrow. And David, seeing that his life was nearing its end, David knew that. Thine, O Lord, is the greatness and the power. Now, if you underline in your Bible, you underline that word power because it means everything. Not only does it mean authority, it means that strength of power. You know why you're saved? Because of God. You know why you're saved? It's because of Christ. You know why you're saved? Because he came to you. You didn't come to him. You know what? That is one of the filthiest doctrines that will be taught, is that you come to Christ. Nothing further could be from the truth, because you know what? You don't love Christ. In and of yourself, you despise him just as much as you despise the rest of the Godhead. You know why? Because we're filthy, ungodly creatures. So we see that David no doubt understood his needfulness before God. And he says, "Thine, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty." Now, I'm going to hit on this and we're going to move on for time's sake. But I want you to look in and focus in on that word glory. Because you know who likes the glory in many, many places you go? The pastor. You know who likes the glory in this earth that we live in? The leaders. You know who loves glory and gets it all the time? Is the Pope. You know, the glory belongs to God.
Yeah.
When the Bible says time and time and time and time again, God be the glory. Listen, it's not just a waste of words and something to take up space. The glory, the Shekinah glory of God, all of it needs to be focused on God. And if we aren't focused on God, what's the point? Why are we here anyway? To God be the glory. And so as he is making this final address of the people, what David is really realizing, it's all about God. Verse 12, both riches and honor come to thee. Now, I've heard a lot of people quote that and say both riches and honor come from thee, and it does. But I want you to see this text says riches and honor come to thee. You know what? Whatever you have, give it to God. If it's something as simple as a piece of bread, you give it to God.
Yeah.
Because they come to him. Anything you have comes to God. Anything that you possess belongs to him. It is part of him. And it's due his worthy name. Give your riches to him. Both riches and honor come of thee. And thou reignest over all. In thine hand is power and might, and in thine hand is to make great and to give strength unto all. Now therefore, our God, we thank thee and praise thy glorious name. But who am I, and what is my people, that we should be able to offer so willingly after this sword? In other words, what gives us the ability? What gives us the desire? What even puts us in a position to do this? And the answer is this: it's simply God. You know, a lot of people will preach, well, He saved me. He wants to save you from going to hell. You know the problem with that? It's not one place in the Bible that's taught. Not even one. Read Ephesians 1, and why did He save you? To bring glory unto Himself. So that filthy, stinking Paul, and don't you think Paul was seeking Christ? He wasn't. Not one even that much of Scripture to teach you that. He was on his way to Damascus to break up that group of believers over there and to stomp them into the dirt just like he had everywhere else. But God intervened. And that's the only thing he did for you. He intervened. If you'd been continued on, there's no decision to make. And that's not real popular teaching in the modern era. But there is no decision to make. The only decision that's made is God. He'll either manifest Himself to you or He won't. That's a very difficult doctrine. People don't like it, but no doubt it is what the Bible teaches. And so He says here, But who am I, and what is my people that we should be able to offer so willingly after this sword? For all things are come from thee, and of thy hand, of thine own hand, we have given thee, for we are strangers before thee. Now, I'm going to touch on this very lightly. And you again, this is all to be introspective. You think about yourself. How strange are you? Do you look different than everybody you know? When you get out in the workplace, do you look different? Do you talk different? We should be a different, peculiar people. The Bible teaches that all too frequently. So if you look like the world, dress like the world, present like the world, you know, probably you don't have nothing real. You say, oh, you're judging. No, I'm just giving you fair warning, because one day I want to stand before God with clean hands. Because, you know, I have a responsibility. So if all you have is repeating a prayer, make your calling and election sure. If you don't have a faith in God that moves you beyond beyond the normal, seek the Lord while He may be found. And so we see here that He's very, very clear that we are just strangers and sojourners. This is not where we belong. The rest of verse 15 says this: as were all our fathers, our days on the earth is a shadow, and there is none abiding. Now, I want you to see the Bible says, well, what is a shadow? Well, look at the shadow of this building. It starts out in the morning, and the shadow hits us. And most of the shadow is behind this building. And by the end of the day, the trees on the back don't give us a lot of shadow. But at the end of the day, it's kind of toward the east, you know, over this way just a little bit. And then it's gone. And you know how long that takes? About 12 hours. About 12 hours, and that's that. So you think, and you know what? A shadow always looks at like what is being reflected. If it's a house like this one, it looks like a house. If it's a tree, it looks like a tree. But it passes and it moves just a very quick, short time, and then it's gone. So really, what the only thing that really matters if you live to be 100, do you know Christ? Do you have a personal relationship with Him? Has He saved your never dying soul? That's really all that matters. When everything is said and done, there's nothing left to evaluate. It's simply this: do you really know Christ? And if you do know Christ, what does it drive you to? Because it drives us all to the same thing. Verse 16. Oh, Lord our God, all this store that we have prepared to build thee a house, for thy holy name cometh of thy hand, and it is all thine own. Now, I'm not going to get too deeply into what they were prepared to do. But I will say this. It was a number of years before they were able to do this. David wasn't allowed to build the temple because he had bloody hands. So it's set in store for a long time. You know what? You may have some stuff that just needs to, that's set in store a while and you should get out and use it. I fully believe that the Lord God of heaven saves all for a purpose. And we sit and abide and we don't do nothing for years. You know what? The Lord's not pleased with that. The Lord's not as pleased, is not pleased with us just sitting and doing nothing. Otherwise, I think we'd be at home with Him and be at His feet, giving Him praise and glory that's due His name. Verse 17, I know also, my God, that thou triest the heart. Now, why would He try your heart? Is our God not sovereign? Sure He is. Is He not omnipotent? That's what the Bible says, is that He's all-knowing. And to try something isn't, oh, I'll try it if I like it. No, it's, He wants to see how well you lead. Now, He knows how well you lead. He wants to see you, when He gives you a right-hand pull, that you turn right. And He also wants you to see when you balk and say, I ain't going to do it. I'm going to keep going the way I've been going. He wants you to see it. Because listen, He doesn't need the information. He's God. He's sovereign. And He's all-knowing. So He wants you to see it. He wants you to understand exactly where you're at. So as David is giving his final address, and no doubt getting to the point where he's very near death, I know also, my God, that thou triest the heart. And he certainly knew that. He had been through so many things in his life, even from the point of a shepherd boy taking the life of a bear and a lion, all the way to the point with his sinful act with Bathsheba, and then doing murder to cover that up. He had been tried, and he understood himself probably better than you understand yourself. He knew what he was made out of. Now the question is, do you really know what's in here? Do you really know what motivates you? Is it money? Is it to impress people? Is it to have nice new things? Or is your mind really focused on Christ? See, David knew that he needed, and he certainly had been tried. Two things that always is mindful of me with David when he was running from Solomon, or maybe it was Absalom. I think it was Saul, though. He made this statement. Everybody was ready to kill him. He said, I encourage myself in the Lord. See, it got down where even the ones that had stuck with him to the very end was now against him. And his only option was to encourage himself in the Lord. You know what? It's a wonderful, good thing. You know, look about you this morning. You have your brothers and sisters in Christ. You say, well, there's not that many of us. Well, that's a lot more than what David had. That's a lot more than what David had. And he said, I encouraged myself in the Lord. Now, that's where we need to be when we get down to nothing. We have the person of Christ to encourage us even where we're at. Another thing that makes me remember David, again, time and time and time dealt with. Absalom, oh my son Absalom. You know that quote, it comes from after Absalom had died. You know what Absalom was? He was a rebel. From the inside out, from his long hair to the day he was finally stabbed through, he was nothing but a living rebel. But you know what? David found out that he loved him. David loved Absalom, loved him dearly. But look at the flip side. What does the Bible teach us? If father or mother or children or their beings, and we're to put that aside and say, I want to serve the Lord. I'm interested in me and him only. And so as David is writing this final address, he says, my advice to you is to know where you stand. I know also, my God, that thou triest the heart and hast pleasure in what uprightness, sticking close to the Lord, getting sin out of the life. Thou hast pleasure in uprightness. As for me, in the uprightness of my heart, I have willingly offered all these things. And now have I seen with joy thy people. Now I want you to see, it says, I've offered all these things. And the result, he saw other people doing it too. That was the joy of it. Was people that maybe Sherman didn't have nearly as much money as King David did, bringing in of what they had and giving it to the Lord. See, that's the thing. We need to try ourselves. We need to know what we're made about. We need to know why we do something. And you know what? You need to know why you don't do something. What keeps you from that? We need to be a tried people and a people that learns to depend on the Lord more and more and more as time goes on. And so we see that as David is finishing this, he wanted to know his heart. He wanted to know where he was at. He wanted to know what was going on within him. Now, go with me to the Gospel of Mark. Mark chapter 12. And kind of a continuation, something very similar. The Lord Jesus was once again on the hot spot as where his people like to put him. Mark chapter 12 and verse 29. Mark chapter 12 and verse 29. The Bible says, and Jesus answered him, says, first of all, the commandments is this, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Now, let me get you, because there's been an attack of recent, even among certain others, of supposedly one time of our own people, against the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is a real person. He's part of the Godhead. And I'd be willing to go this far. If you don't know the Holy Ghost, you probably don't know Christ. Because you can't know one without knowing the other. See, that's what moves it from logic and knowing that there was a man named Jesus and knowing him. And we should never minimize the work of the Holy Ghost or the Holy Spirit. And so we see that as the Lord Jesus was being once again ridiculed and being brain quizzed on what he knew about the law, he begins and Jesus answered him and says, the first of all the commandments is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Thou shalt have, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. Now, I want you to see that this is the thing. You love God. Now, if you love God, what happens? It becomes a very singular relationship, and that relationship is above all others. Friends don't matter. Romance doesn't matter. Family doesn't matter as much anymore. You are singularly focused in on the Lord Jesus. And so, notice what he says. Love God with all thy heart and with all thy soul. They seem to be the same thing, but they're not. I've even seen people try to put the two together, but they're not. Now, the question is, you can love him with your soul, that's the inward man, right? But do you love him with your heart? See, this is the thing I see in the modern day Christian. Is in another gospel, I think it's Gospel of John, he says, love him with singleness of heart. Just you and him. That's everything that you have. That's what makes you up. If you're a nurse, you love him while you're nursing. If you lay block, you put every block in line thinking that you would do it as a, even unto Christ. Everything you do, it's all about him. And you know what? Fearfully, this is one of our measures of redemption. This is one of our measures of salvation. Do we line up to that? Are we doing things about and for Christ? And with all my mind. Now, you think about your mind, and you think how corrupt it is, and you think on what junk we put into that. What's your mind thinking on, even this morning? You know, one reason I'm very cautious, not as cautious as I should be, not as cautious as I used to be, about TV, is because that's slop, and it is slop. Everybody here has been on a farm. We know what slop is for. It will get in your mind, and it will stay there the rest of your life. And if you don't know what slop is, it's the waste that we give to the hogs. And right here needs to be as pure as we can get it. You say, well, Brother Larry, that's part of the flesh. It can't be pure. Listen, I understand that, but it can be a lot purer if it wasn't exposed to the stench of this world like it is. It could be a lot purer, right? Could be something that we use to focus in on the things of God, and rather than focus in on the things that this world has to offer and the things that this world consumes us with on a daily basis. And with all thy strength, this is the first commandment, and the second is likened this, namely, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is none other commandment greater than these. So he reduces it to two things. Now I want you to see that he says, I want you to love your neighbor as thyself. That means you nurture your neighbor. You give your neighbor the things that they need. You pray for your neighbor. You look for your neighbor to be knowledgeable of the scripture. You love your neighbor. Now what he's done is broke up the first four, which was love God, and the last six, which love man. Because you know what? If we love man and we don't, there'd be no murder.
That's right.
If you loved man, you would be for your wife and your wife would be for you, and there would be no adultery. See, those two principles would take care of all 10 of the commandments, would they not? And so we see then, as the Lord's people today, what really hinges on this, again, we don't like it, but this is a measure, if we've been with Christ or if we have not been with Christ, which is the situation, verse 32. And the scribes said unto him, well, Master, thou hast said the truth, for there is one God, and there is none other but he. And to love him with all thine heart, with all thine understanding, with all the soul, and with all the strength, and to love thy neighbor thyself is more than all burnt offerings and sacrifices. And when Jesus saw, he answered discreetly. He said, thou art not far from the kingdom of God.
Yeah.
Now, this is the quirks, and people don't like it. He ain't got there yet. You know, I think a lot of people get about as close as this young man did. I really believe that. But about that close to King, you know what? There's a lot of people that slide off the pews of many different so-called churches. And many, many, many different Baptist churches, and right into the fiery pits of hell. Because like this young man, they were about that close. And they just didn't get it. So I would definitely recommend that you this morning, that claim to be of the Lord and love the faith, that you really evaluate and look and review what you have in and of yourself. Because listen, we're here for a very short time, and then it's gone, it's done. And one day we'll be pushing up the daisies in the next lot over here beside the building, and nothing else will matter. quit my job. And it wasn't from any of God's people, praise be the name for that, or at least I hadn't heard of it directly. But I've had nurse after nurse and person after person come to me. Don't you want that retirement? And all I simply say to them, they got a lot better retirement than that. Right?
Yeah.
You know what any kind of federal retirement and state retirement really consists of? Whoever's in the driver's seat. That's really all it is, isn't it? So if drivers change, you may or may not have it. Right?
Right.
So people don't like that, but that is the truth, is it not? The government does not have to write us a check out, even though many people are convinced of that. It doesn't have to be that way. And so I want you to see that in focusing on this, what really happens, what really matters only is your soul. What really matters is only what you stand in Christ. Not plus nothing, minus nothing. Do you know the Lord Jesus Christ? And you say, oh, Brother Larry, I don't know. Well, let me tell you this. What fills your time? Is it movies? Is it genealogy? That's sometimes my vice. What fills and occupies your time, and that is your God. Write down to this. And if all you know to do this is play some kind of stupid game, that is your God. Not real popular preaching, isn't it? But I want you to look at yourself and look at yourself really, really good. Do you know Christ? Do you really know Him? Are you in a relationship with Him as believers should be? Look with me in Acts chapter 8. I want to read you a story of a fake. An apostolic fake. Acts chapter 8 in verse 13. Acts chapter 8 in verse 13. Then Simon himself believed also. Now, I'm not going to read it for time's sake this morning, but you know what Simon's problem always was, and he's described this way. Putting off himself as if he were some great one.
Yeah.
That's exactly what the Bible says about Simon. Yeah. And I met a lot of men, I met a lot of women, I met a lot of preaching men, that about all you can say about them is they put themselves off as though they were some great one. You know what makes someone great? Do they know the Lord Jesus Christ, really? Or are they faking? Are they just going through the motion? What's your situation this morning? Where do you stand? Do you know Him or do you not know Him? Are you with Him? Or are you in the person of Christ or are you not? So Simon was a fake. Then Simon himself believed also. Now, I want you to see that the belief did not mean redemption. The belief did not mean that he knew Christ. We're in the gateway to the south. Everybody believes there was a man named Jesus. But that doesn't make you saved. Then Simon himself believed also. And when he was baptized, he continued with Philip and wondered, beholding the miracles and the signs which were done. Now, I want you to see that Philip, that this young man was blown away by what Philip could do in an apostolic sense. You know, that he could do things and implant healing at the hand of God, that he was just blown away. And you know what? I've seen some people blown away by Mr. Personality. By just being somebody that's charismatic and could pull people in. And really, if you get down what they're saying and boil the water off, they're really not saying nothing. We call that politics in the new day. Right? And so we see then that this young man, not enamored by Christ and not pulled by Christ, but rather pulled by what Philip could do. Verse 14, now when the apostles which were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent unto him unto them Peter and John, who, when they were come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. For as yet it was not fallen upon none of them, only them that were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Ghost. And when Simon saw that through the laying on of the apostles' hands the Holy Ghost was given, he offered them money. He showed himself for who he was.
Yeah.
Now, I point out, because we are going to focus on Simon, because Simon was fake. And if you're a fake this morning, I want you to know that you're a fake. But I do want you to know this. In regards to what you think, they laid hands on them and they prayed and they received the Holy Ghost. That's all we can do. Plus nothing, minus nothing, right? I understand all that now, but I do know that's what the Bible says. It was given to them to do that. And that's why Simon was jealous. That's why he was upset. You watch jealous people. You watch them. You know what? I have seen people jealous over something as meaningless as this little book. And the reason they were jealous is because someone else had it and they didn't. You know what? That ain't named among God's people. What we should is God's people is, you like my book? Better have it, enjoy. Hope you get some good times out of it. See, that speaks of Christ. You know what? When someone gets something new and it makes you mad, you might need to look at yourself. Instead of rejoicing with them, like, man, that makes me mad. I deserve that more than they. That does not speak of the kingdom of God. And so we need to be very cautious. And certainly know what we stand with the Lord. Verse 19, he says, saying, give me also this power, that whomsoever I lay hands on, he may receive the Holy Ghost. Now, knowing what Simon's nature was previously, if Simon did have this apostolic gift to give the Holy Ghost, what do you suppose he would have done with it? I think he would have sold it. Because I think that's what his nature was. I think he was money crazy. And if I'll give you $40 if you want the Holy Ghost, I can give it. So just cough up. That's what made him tick. What makes you tick? Why did you come here this morning? Did you come here because it's Mother's Day? Did you come here because you know I would come looking for you if you didn't? What brought you here this morning? Because what brought Simon the sorcerer was not a craving for the things of God. It was things that he could see. Said from the beginning of my ministry, I like very plain buildings. This is a plain building. And the reason I like plain things is because things like redness and velvet and gold, all they do is drive the flesh. And that's the kind of person Simon was. Verse 20, but Peter said unto him, thy money perish with thee, because thou hast thought that the gift of God may be purchased with money. Thou hast neither part nor lot in this matter, for thy heart is not right in the sight of God. See, Peter knew now for sure that he was a fake. He said, listen, you don't have no part in this. You don't even know what it's talking about. Fakes will come out. Fakes will come out eventually. But you know what? They're not revealed to everyone. You know what? I fully believe this. There's people pushing up daisies this morning that were nothing more than a fake. This is Brother Junior quoted a verse that I enjoy. At the last judgment, at the first judgment, there were many saying to me, did I not prophesy in thy name? And he said, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, I never knew you. Now that gets in, and I'll give you this for food for thought. This is extra. Is God all-knowing? triest, right? I hope you believe that. When well, he said, when he said, I never knew you, what was he saying? He didn't know him as Redeemer. He didn't know him as Father. He knew he existed. In fact, he knew him as a reprobate and as a vessel of wrath. But he did not know him in redemption. So I ask you this morning, do you know the Lord Jesus? And more important, does he know you? Does he know you as salvation? Does he know you in those terms? Because we find that Simon was a man that walked with the very man that beheld the person of Christ. And what happened was, is he was nothing more than a fake. He was nothing more, nothing more than someone that pretended. Jeremiah chapter 17. Jeremiah chapter 17 and verse 9. Jeremiah chapter 17 and verse 9, the Bible says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Now I want you to notice two things about this, this thing called the heart of the soul. First of all, I want you to see that it, the Bible says it is deceitful. Mm-hmm. It likes to play tricks. It likes to play on emotion.
Right.
It likes to play on fear. Tonight, if I said, who wants to go to hell? I'm sure nobody would be like, man, sign me up. I'd love to go down to hell. That sounds like something I'd really enjoy. No, that's foolishness. But I've seen a lot of people present the gospel that way. Haven't you? Problem is, there's no truth in it, right? There's no truth in it. This heart is deceitful. If all you have this morning is a hell avoidance salvation, I'd be very, very, very cautious. Because the heart is deceitful. Secondly, I want you to see that it's desperately wicked. Mm-hmm. There is not one good thing about it.
All right.
Bible says we come from the womb speaking lies. And we do. And listen, it don't improve of age. The only thing it improves by is the intervention of the Lord God. That's the only way that it improves. That's the only thing that makes any difference at all. So we find that it's desperately wicked and it's deceitful. It will play tricks on you. And then the last question says, who can know it? Now, what I want you to do, remember the whole emphasis of today's message is this. Do you know yourself? What is this heart saying? What is this inward man doing? Who can know it? God. You know what? Your soul's condition is a revealed truth. Because most people never even arrive at the end fact that they are fully wicked in all ways. The most some get is, well, I'm wicked, but I can make a decision to follow Jesus. No. If we had that much good about us, whatever, the law would have worked. Right? Because we could have followed him in the law. But it's that deceitful, that ungodly. So the answer, who can know it, is Christ. The answer of who can know it is the Lord God Jehovah. The answer of who can know it is the person of God and Him alone. And then our needs, our salvation, our person is a revealed truth, just like the rest of the truths that dwells in that book. Saved or lost, it's not cognition. It is a revealed truth only from God. And He can give it. Seek ye the Lord while He may be found. I want to know where I stand for Christ. You say, well, you've been saved for 35 years. Well, my Bible tells me this, make your calling and election sure. And it don't tell me how frequently to do it. So you know what I do? I do it a whole lot.
Right.
And so we see then, we as the Lord's people, we need to know where we stand. You need to know if you're really Christ. You need to know if you really are His or whether you're not. What's within your heart? Last place I want to read in 2 Samuel chapter 6. 2 Samuel chapter 6, verse 16. We read of a woman who was a fake. She was a charlatan. She did not cherish the things of God. 2 Samuel chapter 6 and verse 16, the Bible says, "And when the ark of the Lord came into the city of David, Michal, Saul's daughter, looked through a window and saw the king David leaping and dancing before the Lord, and she despised him in her heart." Now you talk about a wicked, lost woman, Michal, or Michelle, however you want to say that, she was it. See, David was coming and going, "Praise the Lord! Thank you for His goodness! The ark's back where it ought to be! It's finally in the house of God! Blessed be the name of the Lord!" They were taking it to Jerusalem for the very first time, and they were giving Him praise and glory and honor. Instead of being happy with Him, Michelle looks off in there and says, "Man, I hate that guy!" And I have seen that in a lot of people. Just despised because they're at peace with God. Upset and mad because someone else knows they're comfortable with their salvation. Upset because they're giving praise to God. There's that man, he's a fake. That makes me sick. You know what? If that is your situation this morning, you need to be sure you know the Lord. You need to be sure that you're very sure that you know Him. Because listen, this life is very, very short lived. You know, you're here and you're gone and you're done. And it don't take very long. Just snap and we're through with it. So, do you know Him or do you not? Does He know you? Has He saved your soul? Has He manifested Himself to you ever? And I'm not talking about saying a little prayer. I'm asking you, do you know Christ? And if you answered yes to that in your mind, does it drive you to the things of God? Because that's the real clinch of the matter. If you don't believe that, read the entirety of the book of James this week. And the whole thing, does it result in works or does it not? Baptist people don't like to talk about works, and the reason why is because really it's an indicator, do you know Him or do you not? That's why.